Good morning, everybody. Thank you for joining us. We are going to get started in just a minute here. Just waiting for a few people to join. But thanks for joining our virtual demo of the ALX Pro and MACoat custom finish systems. All right, good morning, everybody. Thank you for joining us today. Welcome to Westcoat's virtual demo on the ALX Pro and MACoat custom finish. My name is Mallory Cabading, and I'm the Business Development Manager with Westcoat. Today on the call with me is Bill England, who is our Technical Sales Manager for the Southern California area. He is going to be on for any questions that you guys may have. Please feel free to enter those questions into the chat or the Q&A. We'll go through a few house rules and then we will go ahead and get started. So a few house rules here. So you will be muted throughout the entire presentation. Like I mentioned, if you have any questions, just go ahead and throw them into the chat and we will be monitoring that and answer your questions live if we can get to them. If not, we're gonna do a quick Q&A after each system has been demonstrated. After each system, we will also do a raffle for a swag bag, Westcoat swag bag. So actually it'll be a question. We'll ask a question. The first person to answer will be the winner. And then those of you who stay on the entire call will be entered into a raffle to win $200 of Westcoat material credit. So make sure you kind of stick with us here. The format today is a little bit different. So if you have joined one of our live demonstrations before, you will notice today's gonna be just a little bit different. So we've actually pre-recorded everything we wanna show you. So it's gonna be a little bit more close up. You know, we're gonna have really close details for you to see. So again, if you've got any questions, we can kind of pause throughout, you know, answer those questions and help you out with install. A little bit about Westcoat before we get started, if you aren't familiar yet, we've used the four, or we have four categories of systems that we offer, and we've used the West in Westcoat to kind of break up these categories. So the WP is for waterproofing. That's what we'll talk about today. So I have two different waterproofing systems, one over concrete, which is the MACoat system, and then one over plywood, which is the ALX system. Again, we will dive into both of those systems today. So yeah, kind of stay tuned and answer all, or ask all those questions you may have. The EC is our epoxy coat line, and this is going to be industrial and decorative epoxies. We have a full line of, you know, clear epoxies, pigmented epoxies, everything from a, you know, quartz system to a urethane system. So a lot of different offerings there. The SC line is our concrete stains and sealers. And so that's going to be translucent stains and, you know, different types of sealers with different types of sheens. These can be used in interior and exterior spaces. And then the last thing here is our texture coat line. And again, same thing here, we're gonna have finishes for interior and exterior spaces. The great thing here, again, if you kind of have a substrate that you're not really liking exactly what you're seeing, you can really use this texture coat line to cover up the existing conditions and create a blank slate. Westcoat has 13 reps nationwide. You can see here on the map, this map will be sent out to you with follow-up emails next week. And you can really just kind of see, you know, where we've got our coverage. Westcoat is headquartered in San Diego, California. And so we do have a lot of reps on the West Coast, but we definitely have coverage throughout the United States. So we're happy to help you however we can. I'm gonna show you a quick video of our headquarters here in San Diego, and we will get started.
Hi, welcome. My name is Todd Cook. We're here in San Diego, California at the headquarters of Westcoat. Why don't you come on inside? You can contact us at Westcoat through our website, via email, or also directly reach out to us via phone. You'll always be greeted by a friendly voice.
Hi, I'm Donna here at Westcoat. I work as inside sales and am happy to answer any questions you may have.
Here we are inside our showroom at the Westcoat headquarters. You can see we have process samples and our category breakdown. At Westcoat, we have a four category breakdown: WP, or our waterproof category. The E in Westcoat is for our epoxy coat. The S in Westcoat is for our surface coat. And the T in Westcoat is for our texture coat. At Westcoat, we ensure your orders are correct and shipped out on time.
Hi, I'm Taylor, and I am in charge of receiving and shipping all the orders here at Westcoat.
Here we are in our sample room at Westcoat. We have process samples, cured samples, we have color charts, and sell sheets or cut sheets available for architects, applicators, and professionals. Here's one of our process samples that shows the system, all the steps or layers, and you can see a nice finish. In addition to our process samples, we also have 3x3 cured samples that show texture, finish, color, and these are available upon request for any of our customers. So in addition to process samples and cured samples, we also offer system brochures and color charts. We also have a full line of liquid samples available for any of your on-site mock-ups. Here we are in our warehouse. These are all the finished goods that we have. All these products are ready for your next project. Here we are in our sample making space. This is where we make all our standard cured samples. We also make custom samples for architects, like this sample here. This is the fine gentleman behind all of our handmade samples.
Hi, my name is Nern. I'm in charge of sample department.
So here we're in our training room. This is a nice space where we do virtual training recently. We've also done in-person training and educational events. We also share the space and do some product testing in this space as well.
And I'm Mike Pittman. I work on product development and technical support.
I want to thank everyone for tuning in. Appreciate your time. If you have any questions regarding any of our products or systems, or you've got an upcoming project and you need some support, we're happy to help. Feel free to reach us at westcoat.com, or you can also contact us at 1-800-250-4519. Thank you and have a wonderful day.
All right, so, again, thank you so much for joining us today. We're gonna go ahead and get started. So, you know, Todd kind of showed you around our warehouse just a little bit there. So you kind of understand where we're coming from and, you know, what we have to offer here at Westcoat. Again, like I had mentioned, this presentation is a little bit different. So we are actually going to have pre-recorded videos that we're gonna, you know, speak over. And I've got Bill here with me. Ask your questions, you know, make sure you kind of, you know, get some answers to anything that you may be interested about today. So I'm gonna go ahead and pop over to the video. One second here. All right, so we're gonna go ahead and get started. There's gonna be some information about prep. This is gonna be pre-recorded, and then Bill and I will go live and answer all your questions. Thanks, guys.
Westcoat ALX Pro is a waterproof walking deck system that is designed for balconies, corridors, and landings. ALX Pro is regularly specified for apartments, hotels, condominiums, and office buildings. It can also be stapled through most old deck systems to provide an excellent method for rehabilitation. ALX Pro is designed for use on plywood. The system gives plywood the look and feel of concrete with a decorative appeal. The system consists of sheet membrane, metal lath, base coat, fiber lath, fiber lath resin membrane, slurry coat, texture coat, and top coat. The ALX Pro system has many advantages, including up to a 20-year warranty, quick access after installation, sound reduction qualities, and a fiber lath reinforced membrane. ALX Pro is ICC evaluated, provides a Class A and 1-hour fire rating, and can provide a Class 1 vapor retarder. Plywood shall have a maximum joist span of 16 inches. Plywood must be 5/8 inch, 3/4 inch preferred, CDX or exterior grade. The deck shall be tongue and groove, completely blocked and nailed. Glued and screwed is best. OSB is not a suitable substrate for this material. Slope must be a minimum of 1/4 inch per linear foot to allow for proper drainage. Be sure the surface is clean, dry, and free of any grease, paint, oil, dust, or any foreign material that may prevent proper adhesion. Do not apply to wet plywood. Dry plywood is typically defined as having less than 10% moisture rating.
Alrighty, every guy. Okay, so we're gonna dive in here. And first thing we're trying to talk about is seam treatment. So first step in the ALX or ALX Pro system is going to be treating your plywood seams. So in this portion, we're gonna show a 6-inch detail. And again, we're just applying this to our plywood seams here. And this is going to be, to reinforce those seams with this this seam tape here.
You can also put it under the flashing as you see Mike doing here. It can also go over the flashing if that's already installed. And we do have a 36-inch option as well for full coverage for, which is really good when you have occupied space below, large areas, or if you're doing under tile applications or an underlayment application.
Absolutely, and we'll go ahead and show that 36-inch now. So full coverage, again, like Bill mentioned, if we really wanna make sure we have backup waterproofing, the WP40 also comes in a 36-inch roll. We're going to kind of highlight to the WP43, which is the sheet membrane primer. So yeah, again here, just making sure that you, apply the primer to the deck. Make sure you only cover as much as you can, put sheet membrane over within 4 hours. If it does go past that 4-hour window, you will have to reprime. So again, once it kind of gets tacky about 2 to 4 hours later, we're going to put the WP40 full sheet membrane down on top of the deck.
And again, excuse me, full sheet membrane, full WP40 is really good when you're anticipating a lot of movement, you're over occupied space. Using that primer is going to give you really good adhesion of the product. And again, also, it is required when we're doing underlayment applications. It's an option for the standard ALX Pro. As Mallory mentioned, you could just do the 6-inch seam treatment, especially if you're doing areas that are not above occupied space, maybe cantilever decks, smaller deck areas, that kind of thing. roof decks, those types of conditions. I always do recommend the full sheet membrane.
Absolutely. And, you know, we're really showing here this 2-inch overlap is really important. You're going to see that throughout a couple different portions, but overlapping all this, all of these materials is really important for proper waterproofing. So when we talk about flashing, you know, we're going to kind of look at a couple details here, but minimum 26 gauge bondarized sheet metal flashing is an industry standard for decks.
And you see what Mike Pittman, who's one of our technical specialists down here in San Diego, you know, one of the critical factors in any waterproof coating installation when it comes to flashing is making sure that you're cutting the flashing properly, you're not butting on your outside corners or your inside corners, that you are cutting and lapping the flashing properly to maintain that 4 to 6 inch overlap.
Absolutely. And our WP 51 polyurethane sealant can be used to, you know, treat those edges and the overlap. So yeah, 2 beads again, if on all your seams, 2 beads of WP 51, again, just to kind of seal that up. And then you're still going to want to nail you're flashing down in those spaces. And nailing your flashing in a staggered pattern every 46 inches.
Also critical, just to make sure that that flashing is secured, that when you get expansion and contraction in the deck, that the flashing is able to stay in place. You don't want to worry about the transition between the flashing and the deck. So fastening it properly is critical.
Absolutely. And I think where we see, you know, a lot of, you know, kind of failure within a deck system is at flashing edges. If it's not properly adhered to the deck, or if you don't do the overlap, you know, you can kind of see those seams telegraph through.
This is a nice post detail. You can see the flashing prefabricated, which makes it really nice. There's no seams, no joinery, slips right over. Always best practice when you can do custom sheet metal, have it made and installed in the field.
Absolutely. So now onto the metal lath system, or I'm sorry, the metal lath portion. So WP25 is the metal lath that is used in, again, the ALX Pro or ALX standard system, along with WP10 staples. And this is a pretty important detail when we come to the ALX Pro system, you know, leaving the metal lath 2 inches back from the deck edge. This allows you to take each one of the coats of the ALX Pro system and really taper towards that edge.
It's also a little different than our standard ALX system. So that's worth noting if you're not doing the ALX Pro system, exactly where you're gonna end that, the lath at your edges.
Absolutely. You know, this is a good one here, you know, the grain with the curve side down so that you can kind of, you know, kind of hugs the deck instead of kind of pops off the deck. Starting in the center, working your way out, you know, and a really important step here is using at least 16 to 20 staples per square foot. You really want to make sure, again, that this metal lath is bonded to the deck properly.
And your seams also critical. We are overlapping the seams, so it's important to make sure you're stapling every 1 to 2 inches on those seams. And as you can see Mike here, he's hammering down any high spots to make sure that nothing protrudes up when you come back later with your base coat. And again, 2 inches from all deck edges, as Mallory mentioned, to allow the product to taper down at your edges.
All right, under our base coat here. So what we're showing here is our TC1, which is our base coat cement, and then WP81 cement modifier. A WP81 comes in 1 gallon and 5 gallon buckets. Mike was showing basically, you know, the whip that you would use to mix this material together.
Yeah, and you can see it's a gallon and a quarter of the WP81 cement modifier. Now we up the polymer a bit when we're filling the lath. You see as an option up to 1 quart of water. That's really only gonna be needed in hot weather where it's skinning over fast. I don't typically recommend water in the base coat unless you're in those conditions. It's also worth noting if you're in those conditions, we do have a, cement decelerator, our CA16, that can be used as well to slow down the curing of the cement when you're in hot weather applications.
Yeah, absolutely.
We also provide this product in a white as well. So TC1 can be provided in white. Again, a little easier on the trowel guy in those hot conditions when you have a lighter color cement. So we do have that option for you. You can see here, Mike is troweling right up to the edge of the diamond metal wire lath. He's stopping it right there. So the subsequent coat of the ALX Pro system can then go beyond and kind of lock that down and taper that edge.
Yeah, and using that brush at the edge is really nice to help, you know, kind of smooth that edge out. Some guys are really, really great with trowels and they can, you know, kind of really dive in. Mike's been doing this for a long time, so he's pretty good at this, but you know, use your tools, they're your friends.
Yeah, you're just gonna trowel tight to fill the lath. You're still gonna see the lath through the base coat. That's okay, we're not trying to completely encapsulate it to where you don't see it at all. You really just wanna use the lath kind of as a gauge to trowel the material in as tight as possible.
And this goes about 40 square feet per batch.
Per batch, correct. Yeah. And right there, he's just, again, as he's troweling, if he sees a high staple, he can knock it down. You can also use the hammer to kind of temper the deck to help with trowel lines.
Yep. So once we're dry, typically, you know, an hour or two in 70 degrees, kind of, you know, scrape off any high spots, make sure, you know, your base coat's ready to go to get your fiber lap membrane. All right, onto our fiber lath and resin membrane. So what you see here is the WP47H, which is a heavy duty fiber lath. You know, you're just gonna roll it out, lay it down on the deck.
Yeah, this product comes in 38 inches by 50 feet. So you yield about 450 to 475 square feet of roll. There is a 2-inch overlap. So you basically end up with a 36-inch roll when you account for your overlaps. This is what makes the ALX Pro system the Pro system. So, you know, within the ALX line, we have options. And this is our belts and suspenders. This is the Pro system. So there is this one additional step. If you were not doing ALX Pro and you're just doing ALX system, you could omit this step.
Yep. And this really kind of, if you're familiar with the MACoat system, takes part of the MACoat system and puts it on top of the ALX system. So we're still using that TC1 base coat, but we're going to mix it now with 5 gallons of WP90.
Yeah, can you pause it now real
yeah.
quick? I just want to real quick pause the video and kind of explain why we have this component, this ALX Pro system. So by reinforcing with the fiber lath and what we call the MACoat mix, the WP90 you see there, it basically allows more crack mitigation properties. It's a highly flexible, waterproof resin that goes into the fiber lath. So really critical on large areas where you expect a lot of expansion and contraction in your plywood. If you have a lot of irregular shapes, you know, this is a really good system to help mitigate any cracking that may occur through expansion and contraction. So that's really why we have this option. It is for those large areas, those sensitive areas, or areas where you may be looking for a longer warranty period.
Absolutely.
You can resume the video.
Yeah, no, that's great information. Because again, you know, why would we use this over just standard, you know, ALX? And, you know, Bill makes some good points there, but if you ever have a question about that, reach out to your rep. We're happy to help you and dial in what you need for your exact project. So again, here, you know, you can kind of see, put all our liquids in first and then our cements, kind of mix it up real good. Make sure you don't have any dry cement in there still, and then we will pour the mixture out.
And again, this is 5 gallons to a bag. So you're most likely going to be splitting 2.5 gallons to half a bag or so. It's very wet mix. So that way we can trowel through the fiber lath and get good contact onto the base coat. So you do want to trowel it tight to get that 250 to 275 square feet per batch. And it trowels nice. You can see Mike makes it look easy, but it's actually, it's one of my favorite mixes to trowel myself. Again, tight just to fill that fiber lap.
Yep, absolutely. And on this coat here, you can see we're holding it back on the flashing edge about 1/2 inch. So again, we held the, you know, metal lap 2 inches back. This is gonna be 1/2 inch. We're really tapering that edge. And same thing here, you know, about 1 hour to 4 hours, depending on the weather, this is gonna, you know, dry fairly quickly, scrape off all your high spots, and then move on to your slurry coat. So our slurry coat here, we're gonna say it used that same TC1 base coat cement. We're gonna go back to the WP81 modifier.
And up to 2 quarts of water. Again, to get the desired consistency, you know, you can do 1 quart or up to 2, depending on the weather and the consistency you need.
So again, we're kind of, you know, gonna just mix this up. The one thing you see on the bucket there, that's it's called a whale tail, and that is something that kind of helps you with the cement that's kind of flying into the air when you're pouring that into the bucket. So that's helpful on site.
Yeah, they didn't have those when I was in the field. I'd go home and cough up a driveway
just
every night.
Just breathe it in. Yeah. So something, you know, Mike did here was kind of tape off the edge so that, you know, it can kind of create a clean edge there. Again, you know, some guys don't do this technique, but it's something that you can use if you need to.
No, it's really important for two reasons. For one, you want to keep your, you know, your thickness of this coat all the way up to the edge. And you don't want it running down your drip edge all over your flashing and have to come back later with a ladder and clean that edge up. You know, we have the benefit here of doing it where we can get around all four sides, but on your job, you definitely want to mask off that drip edge and make sure that you don't have material running over the side.
Yeah. Or if you have like a unit below, if it's an, you know, multi-unit, you've got to clean up the unit below. That's never fun.
So this coat dries pretty quick, depending on the weather, 30 minutes to 2 hours. This, at this point, we're technically waterproof. So if you're doing like a multi-family type project, and yeah, you can pause it, Mel.
Yep.
And you know, they want to get dried in. This is kind of where you would stop at what we consider a construction coat. So, you know, a lot of times if you're doing a large project or even a custom home, they may want to get the flashing in so they can get the doors in, the stucco going, all that good stuff. It's nice to be able to get the flashing in and then get the deck waterproof to this level. And then you can pull off, let all the other trades come in and hopefully not make a mess all over your coating, but at least to let them do what they need to do. And then you can come back once they're done, hopefully with minimal cleaning, and then continue the system. So this is a great benefit to this type of system versus, you know, some slip sheet or fluid applied systems that do have recoat windows. Mm-hmm. So that once you start, you really kind of have to finish.
Yeah, absolutely. So, and this allows you to kind of get to a point too, where, you know, you're ready for your finishes. If for some reason your client wants to change their mind, this is the point where you do it.
And you can also see we did bring it all the way to the edge. So we've now gone all the way to the edge of that flashing, feathered that edge. And, you know, every step we kind of went a little further onto the edge of the flashing. So.
And that's, again, to make sure we don't have a really thick edge on that outside edge there. We want to make sure the water can get off the edge. So texture, you want to talk about the hopper gun real quick?
Sure. So, you know, hopper gun, acoustical hopper gun, similar to what you see for drywall applications, is just a good way to provide either an orange peel or a knockdown texture. There are different orifice sizes. You can adjust the pressure of the compressor to get a more wet mix or a tighter mix. So great way to get the product down for those types of textures.
Yep, absolutely. Okay, and so for this mix here, we're gonna actually use our TC3 medium texture cement. And we're gonna do 1 gallon of WP81 to that TC3. And then again, like Bill had mentioned, up to, you know, a half a gallon of water. This is kind of really gonna depend on the temperature and kind of your working time, how much time you have to kind of work with the material out on the deck.
Yeah, it's gonna depend on where you're at. Here in Southern California, where I'm at, we do traditionally add the water. Pro tip too, in hot weather, mix close to where you're working. Don't try to mix, pour off into the hopper gun, run up 20 flights of stairs, go through the house. You'll have a nice, very
thick,
stiff mix in that hopper gun. So, yeah.
Thick material, that's for sure.
You can see Mike, he's doing just a bit of a little orbital technique here. About 70% coverage and just, you know, nice continuous. It's also nice to have a guy feeding you material so that you don't have to stop in the middle of the deck and go back and mix. It's important to keep a wet edge for consistency.
Yep, absolutely. And about, you know, 150 to 200 square feet per batch is how you'll kind of, you know, get this out. And then, you know, after not very long, again, depending on your temperatures, how much working time here, but you want to knock this down with a rounded pull trowel.
And also, depending on the texture you want, if you get to it a little sooner, you're going to spread it out and you're going to knock that texture down even further, flatten it, if you will. Again, Mike has the benefit of going around all four sides of the deck here. If you're on a big job, you can use a standing trowel to knock it down, save your back, be a little more productive.
Right, yeah. That is definitely something that's very helpful.
Yeah, you can go back in with cleats mm-hmm. as well and then knock it down. Here, Mike's just taking a rub stone, just cleaning up that edge, scraping the texture just to knock off any high spots.
Yep, again, you know, depending on the weather, about 30 minutes to an hour, and this will be ready to go for top coat. So there's just a finished, you know, look of that knockdown texture right there.
What is the name of the applicator for hot weather? Sorry, I'm reading one of the questions. Let's say audio dropped out.
Yeah, I think Ryan was the only one maybe. So it seems like everyone else can hear okay.
Oh, sorry about that, Ryan.
So with SC10, this the acrylic top coat. So one thing we really want to make sure is that you box this material or mix all of your material together. And that's going to be all the material you're going to use for the site, just to make sure you have got consistency between, you know, if you've got gallons or 5 gallons.
Yeah, it's important to know if you don't know what box means, it just means take all your material and mix them all together for consistency. They're fairly consistent, but we do have different batch numbers. So when you're doing large areas, just to be safe, it's always best practice to box your material together so that you know your color is consistent. Mm-hmm.
And two thin applications here is actually pretty important, you know, just thin to win, get this down, you know, 200 and 300 square feet per gallon. Definitely want to make sure you have a non-shedding roller though. That is something that could be a headache.
And large areas, this material can be sprayed as well, right out of an airless sprayer. So you can spray and back roll, a lot more productive, especially if you still have masking in place from your knockdown. Mm-hmm. So that's just one coat. So pretty decent hide for that light color. Now Mike's coming back doing the second coat. So as Mallory mentioned, it's about 250 square feet a gallon per coat.
And yeah, cutting those edges in, you know, it's almost, it's the same as painting a wall. You got to do your detail work. And then again, come in with that roller, roll both directions and, you know, kind of get the top coat out on the deck. Something we kind of actually skipped over as well, I just realized, we added our CA30, which is our small safe grip. We have different grits of our safe grip, which is a non-skid additive that you can add into these sealers. So again, if you need added texture, added skid resistance, that's something that you can add in as well.
Which is, you know, this system's often specified in common areas, you know, roof decks, that kind of thing. And so adding a little more slip resistance is always a good idea. To be safe. And you can see Mike here just detailing out the flashing. A lot of times when you come back with your weep screed and your stucco, you will see a couple inches of flashing, or in this case, maybe a collar coming back over the post. You want to make sure that you have that consistent color going up.
And that's about it for this demo. So we're just going to cover maintenance real quick, and we will get to your questions. If you have any questions, go ahead and drop them into the chat.
Establish a routine maintenance schedule for your decorative coating. The ALX Pro system should be inspected for wear every 2 to 4 years. The system should be resealed with the appropriate Westcoat sealer every 3 to 5 years, depending on traffic and UV exposure. For additional information, refer to the spec sheets and general maintenance guide. These resources can be found at www.westcoat.com. If you have any additional questions, feel free to contact us via email at info@westcoat.com or call us at 1-800-250-4519.
Everybody can see what I've been doing at my own house now. I have been looking at how to install vinyl. I think we have a couple questions here. So I think, Timothy, your question about what is, you know, used for the hot weather. I think we're talking about the decelerator, right?
Yeah, I had mentioned our CA16 and concrete accessories is the part number there, CA. And we also have a CA15, which is an accelerator, but the CA16 in hot weather is a decelerator you can add to the TC1 to help slow it down or retard it so that you can have a little more working time in hot weather. It's also great, the accelerator, if you're doing it in cold weather and you want it to cure a little faster before maybe the temperatures drop, you can use the CA15 accelerator. So we have both options for you.
Absolutely. Okay, so I got a question from, real quick, Ryan. Yes, we are recording this and we should have some version of it available for the future reference. Tad, I see your question here. Is there an advantage to bringing the MACoat layer up the deck to the wall flashing?
Yes. I mean, you know, you saw there, we just brought the color coat, the SC10 up. There is absolutely nothing wrong with brushing the resin layer, the slurry coats up onto the flashing, getting into your seams. So definitely a good idea.
Yeah, great question. If we don't have any other questions, I'm gonna show a quick commercial on our TC30, which is our slope mix. And so we did kind of show the entire assembly of this, you know, without adding any additional slope. At the beginning, we had touched on, you know, hoping that the substrate itself actually has slope built into it, that quarter of an inch per linear foot. If you do run into a space where you don't have that provided in the substrate, our TC slope, TC30 slope mix is a really great addition that you can utilize on site. So I'll show this real quick, and then we're going to answer a question for that raffle prize. So stay tuned.
Hey everyone, my name is Todd Cook. I'm the product manager here at Westcoat. We have another product spotlight for you today. We're going to talk about our TC30 slope mix. This material is a very versatile, just add water sloping compound that can be used in our slope technique and our TC slope and patch. It's ideal for use with our ALX, MACoat, and TextureCrete systems. TC30 slope mix is a high strength, trowel grade, single component, polymer modified, cementitious underlayment material. It has high strength, great working time, can be feathered, has excellent adhesion, is fire retardant, cost effective, easy to use, and ideal for use with sloping. This material can be applied from 3 inches down to feather edged. It comes in one 50 pound bag and has a shelf life of 1 year. The material is gray in color and has zero VOCs. Hopefully that was some helpful information on our TC30 slope mix material. If you have any questions about this product regarding its use or how to apply the material, please feel free to reach your local distributor. You can also contact us directly at.
Okay, so again, if you got any questions about TC30, go in. Feel free to pop them into the chat, but it's a really great mix, you know, add water only. It's nice to have on site for those kind of conditions. So we are going to ask a question for a swag raffle. I do believe what we're giving away is Westcoat socks. And so the question here is, what is the part number for the resin and the fiberlac resin membrane coat? Give you guys just a few seconds here to enter that either into the chat.
We don't have the Jeopardy music.
Remember? I know, we need music, that's for sure. All right, Timothy.
Got it.
WP90, good job. All righty, so give me 1 second and I will go ahead and pop up the MACoat custom finish video.
Westcoat. Or try us via phone at 1-8.
The MACoat custom finish system is a fiberlath reinforced deck system installed with a series of acrylic applications and sealed with one of Westcoat's clear sealers. The MACoat custom finish offers a variety of decorative options such as the look and feel of wood, flagstone, or tile.
The MACoat custom finish is mainly used on
Sorry guys, that was on 1.5 times speed.
Mallory's had some caffeine this morning.
Yeah. I'm just ready to get through this thing. Excuse me. Okay, I'm gonna start that over again so y'all don't have to keep up.
The MACoat custom finish system is a fiberlath reinforced deck system installed with a series of acrylic applications and sealed with one of Westcoat's clear sealers. The MACoat custom finish offers a variety of decorative options such as the look and feel of wood, flagstone, or tile. The MACoat custom finish is mainly used on elevated concrete walking decks and is designed for balconies, corridors, stairs, and landings. It is regularly specified for hotels, condominiums, apartments, office buildings, and is suitable for parking structures with vehicular traffic. MACoat custom finish can be applied over existing deck systems to provide an excellent method for the rehabilitation of problem surfaces. The system consists of fiberlath, base coat, slurry coat, grout coat, and custom finish. The MACoat custom system has many advantages. It's flexible, breathable, and durable, and it offers quick access after installation. Concrete must be a minimum of 2 inches thick. Concrete must be clean, dry, and free of grease, paint, oil, dust, curing agents, or any foreign material that will prevent proper adhesion. Slope must be a minimum of 1/4 inch per linear foot to allow for proper drainage. The concrete should be at least 2500 PSI, porous, and able to absorb water. A minimum of 28 days curing time is required on all concrete. All concrete should be tested for moisture before applying a seamless coating. Prepare concrete to a profile equal to CSP 3 as specified by the International Concrete Repair Institute. Cracks greater than 1/32nd of an inch should be routed out to 1/4 inch by 1/4 inch. The WP47A seam tape is designed to reinforce cracks and has an adhesive side for easy application. Install WP47A seam tape over all cracks and seams. Apply EC72 epoxy patch gel into the tape with a trowel or putty knife to smooth. Broadcast with 30 grit silica sand to allow adhesion of the coating. Allow EC72 to cure for 3 to 4 hours before the next coat.
Alrighty, so again, that kind of covers prep and everything that you need to do prior to installation. So we're gonna start off with flashing again.
Any questions on prep before we move on? Well, it's the most important aspect of the job.
Yeah, do we have anything you want to expand on that? I mean, you're right, it is the most important.
Yeah, I think, I mean, we noted in the video, you know, making sure you're getting the concrete surface profile, the CSP 3 to 4 that we require. You know, there's only typically 2 reasons coatings fail. It's lack of prep or excessive moisture. I would consider both those conditions prep, you know, making sure you're achieving the right CSP, making sure that you know your moisture levels. It is critical to a successful outcome with these coating systems. So I know we covered it, but I just want to make sure we kind of reiterate it, because most of the times we do see failures or issues, it tends to be lack of prep. So, you know, you can achieve the CSP traditionally by aggressive diamond grinding or shot blasting. And the best way to get a CSP 3 to 4 is by shot blasting. So, if there's any questions, let us know, but we can move on. I just wanted to touch on that.
We do have a good question. Can you power wash broom finish concrete to get a CSP 3?
No. So, you know, one of the things you have with a broom finish, and a lot of people think because you're doing it, you're achieving a profile. Broom finish, you won't see it on the CSP chart. And part of the problem with that is how they finish it. There's a what we call latenance in concrete. It's kind of the cream that rises to the top. They're using that broom to pull that to the top, they're adding moisture, and they're creating, you know, kind of the cream on the top layer of the concrete. That is not what we want to bond to. we want to cut, grind, blast through that lateness and open the pores up of the concrete. So a broom finish is not an acceptable preparation or substrate. We would want you to profile it mechanically.
Yeah, and if you aren't familiar with this chart right here, so again, we quickly, you know, kind of rolled over this, but this is, you know, industry standard, you know, call out for different types of prep for different types of systems. And so again, this is something you will see across the board in all of our specs.
And I should expand on one thing, I'm sorry. There are, I guess, very high PSI pressure washers that you may be able to remove the broom finish and any lightness, but that would not be your typical, you know, 2,500 PSI pressure washer. It's gonna be something much higher.
Mm-hmm. Quick question for Michael. Do you see that there? Why doesn't this product have the expanded metal layer, metal in the layers?
So the MACoat system specified for concrete substrates. And so we use the fiber lath that you actually saw after the base coat of the ALX Pro. That's where that fiber lath and that resin coat came from, was this system. And because we're going over concrete, we're using a fiber lath versus a diamond metal wire lath, just simply because we can't staple into the concrete.
Mm-hmm, definitely. All right, so we'll get this rolling here. Again, you know, the flashing details themselves are fairly similar. Big thing here, again, you know, like Bill had just mentioned, because of the metal lath, we can't staple through. Same thing here, you know, to adhere the flashing to the deck itself, we're gonna use a different method as well.
Did we already go past the 72?
You know, it's next, and I find okay. that interesting. So
one difference with concrete, if you're flashing it, is we're using our EC72 under the flashing to get a chemical bond. Mm-hmm. We didn't do that on the plywood. We're able to nail onto plywood.
Mm-hmm. And you can see the 72 here. So this is a two component material. We're gonna mix this one-to-one, part A, part B. And, you know, they're two different colors to begin with, you know, a white and a dark gray. Once you start mixing it up, it becomes a light gray. So should be pretty easy, you know, kind of on the mixing station there.
It's worth noting we've improved the viscosity too. Years ago when I used to mix this stuff, it was a little harder to mix. So you can see Mike there, he's just spreading it, looks like with an 1/8 inch notch drow. Again, with concrete, we wanna set the flashing in that epoxy and still do the double cock method on our seams. And then where we're nailing in plywood, you know, staggered every 4 to 6 inches, with concrete, we're gonna ram set as needed to just make sure the flashing seats into the epoxy so that when the epoxy dries, we get that chemical bond and not just a mechanical bond. Mm-hmm. You can see here. So it's again, it's gonna be kind of as needed just to make sure the flashing sits nice and flat.
Yeah, and you know, something we had kind of, I think, glossed over the last one, bondraised sheet metal is, you know, a typical industry standard. I think, you know, this last frame here, if your metal is galvanized stainless steel or copper, and if you need help, you know, kind of detailing that, reach out to us and we can help you. Different types of metals need different types of prep or application methods. So that's something we do, you know, kind of want to touch on as well.
Yeah, bondraised metal is just prepped. You know, it's galvanized metal that's already prepped. It's ready to be coated over. There's no prep in the field. So it can save you labor versus standard galvanized metal. But there are certain areas where stainless steel may be more appropriate. Mm-hmm. You know, so we do call out the level of preparation required when it comes to stainless steel or galvanized metals. And that's noted in our product data sheets. But basically, we're looking for light mechanical preparation and a solvent wipe.
Yep. Making sure we can bond to everything. All right, so now onto our base coat. And with the base coat here, you'll see that same fiber lath. So WP47 gets laid out on the deck, you know, very similar fashion as the ALX Pro system, except for, like we had mentioned, you know, we're not using that metal lath here because we can't staple in, but that fiber lath, we're gonna make sure our base coat is really what adheres this fiber lath to the deck.
And you can see there, it comes in a roll, so it has a little memory from being in a roll, so it's nice to roll it out, cut it, and flip it over so it curls down on your edges. Just helps it lay down, makes it easier when you're troweling into it. Mm-hmm. You can see here, we're overlapping the seams 2 inches. Again, 38 inch roll yields 36 inches with your overlaps and about 450 to 475 square feet of roll.
Mm-hmm. And our base coat is going to be very similar again to that fiberlath resin in the ALX Pro, TC1 and then WP90, the waterproof resin.
And it is 5 gallons to a bag. So again, you know, you're probably in a split or you're gonna mix it in a larger bucket. And so typically it's gonna be, you know, 2.5 gallons to half a bag. Mm-hmm. And we're not adding any water. So this is a waterproof resin where the WP81 we use in the other system is a cement modifier. This actually is our waterproofing resin. So we do not wanna thin this. It's already a very wet mix with 5 gallons to a bag. So there's really no reason to thin it in the field.
Mm-hmm. Again, we're gonna mix our powder into our liquid, mix it up real good. You know, no chunks of dry material in here.
And real quick, I see a question regarding the fastener, the Hiltier Simpson. And yes, you can. So those can be used in lieu of the ram set.
Can one use a Hilti or Simpson gas? Yeah, good question. All right, so our base coat mixture, we're going to trowel this thin into our WP47, about 240 to 275 square feet per batch. And you can see Mike is actually going up to the edge here. We're not holding this edge back at all on this detail.
Well, yeah, we hold the fiberlath back, but yeah, not the resin and the cement.
Yep, right.
And again, brushing, feathering your edges, you know, troweling tight, you're still gonna see a bit of the waffle pattern, if you will, from the fiberlath. That's okay, we really wanna make sure we're troweling through the fiberlath. You can see here where it's slightly raised, you know, concrete's not always perfectly flat. And so you can see Mike, as he's going, he just takes a utility knife, he just cuts a little X, trowels over it to get the material in there. It's not the end of the world if you miss something like that, you come back the next day and you see a couple little areas where it's not laminated down. You can do that before the next coat as well. You can come in and feather patch those areas. So basically cut and then take that brush that he's doing right there in the same mix and just touch up any areas where you may have lifting of the fiberlath.
Yeah, it's fairly forgiving in that sense. All right, again, you know, allow it to dry for a few hours and then you're ready to move on to your slurry coat. We're gonna use that same TC1 base coat cement. And we're gonna use also the WP90 waterproof resin here.
It's the same exact mix, mm-hmm. You know, 5 gallons to a bag. Again, you just don't have to go into the fiberlath here, but it's basically two coats, same process.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so pretty easy mixture. 1 bag to 5 gallons for 2 coats.
And while he's mixing again, it's worth noting, you know, MACoat's for concrete. And one of the attributes to MACoat, besides the fiberlath reinforcement and the dry times, so you can move through the process quickly, is that it is breathable. So, you know, concrete has moisture, and when the sun comes out and it gets hot, concrete expands, and it releases that moisture as vapor. And a lot of other systems, flute applied urethanes and some others, even systems that are completely laminated without the cement, can be prone to bubbling. So the MACoat system does allow some of that vapor to pass through it without desponding. And so it is breathable, which is definitely an attribute when you're installing it over concrete. Mm-hmm.
And this coat's gonna go down, you know, a little bit thinner here. So 300 to 350 square feet per batch. Again, where the first coat, the base coat, you were kind of filling in all the voids in the fiberlath. Here, you're kind of just giving it a good skim coat to cover all that up.
And you do not wanna see the fiberlath anymore. You shouldn't see it after this coat. So now you should have a nice consistent finish and not see that waffle pattern from the fiberlath.
Mm-hmm. Same thing here, yep, after it's dry.
Yeah, do you mind pausing it real quick?
Absolutely.
So we're doing our ALX Pro, you notice we did a standard finish. MACoat, we're doing a custom finish. So at this point of the application, the MACoat system is basically waterproof. If you wanted to do the standard knockdown or a trowel finish, you could do it. We're gonna show you the custom finish, but it's important to note both of these systems, once the waterproofing's done, the finishes are interchangeable. So we just wanted to show you both standard and custom, but you can do either or with the ALX Pro or the MACoat system.
Mm-hmm. Paul had a question here. How does the second coat trowel versus the first coat in the MACoat mix?
Nice. as I mentioned, it's probably my favorite mix to trowel. Maybe it's because I'm not the greatest trowel guy, right? It's real wet. But, you know, when you're troweling the first coat, you're pushing it through the fiber lath. You know, the fiber lath lays nice, and but it can move a little bit on you, you know. So obviously now that it's laminated down or it's, you got your first coat down, coming back with a second coat, it does trowel really nice. It's you can be very productive with this mix.
Like butter. All righty. So onto our grout coat mix. So again, like Bill mentioned, we're going to dive into a pretty custom finish here. So part of that assembly is what we call a grout coat. So this is going to be our TC5, which is a grout coat cement. It's light gray cement, kind of, you know, created for this application. And it's going to, we're going to get back into that WP81 cement modifier.
And we do have a question I'd like to answer now. So if we could pause it. So Tad, great question. And we really probably should have talked about this a little more. So thank you. His question was, when do you use a primer? And traditionally the MACoat system over properly prepared concrete, you do not need a primer. Now, if you're going over an existing system that's, you know, they don't want to remove, or you don't want to remove, or maybe it's still performing, but there's some minor deficiencies, you can prep that system, correct any deficiencies. And that's when you would use our EC11 water-based epoxy primer and a sand broadcast. So basically to marry the systems together. He asked about Aquafin, and I would say, yes, you could use Aquafin SG2 with a sand broadcast if you had moisture issues, or better yet, use our EC15 moisture vapor barrier. We actually do have a moisture vapor barrier that can be used with the MACoat system when you do have moisture that exceeds 75% of an RH or 5 pounds over 1,000 square feet on a calcium chloride test. So if you run across those conditions, I did mention it's breathable, but within reason, you know. So if you do have elevated moisture levels, you can use our EC15 as the primer and then move to the MACoat system.
Yeah, absolutely. Really great question. I popped that part number in there for you guys if you need it. So our mixture here is 1 gallon of WP81 and up to a half a gallon of water. Again, kind of depend on temperature, you know, your working time here. And then 1 bag of that TC5 grout coat cement.
And TC5 is nice. It's just a natural kind of concrete gray. So great for grout. It's also good if you're doing a broom finish, or if you just wanted to kind of trowel it out, make it look like concrete and put a clear on it. You could do that as well. I tend to like that. I'm a simple guy. I kind of like my coating just to look like concrete. And so that can definitely be done with this cement here.
Yep, absolutely. We had a good question from Michael. Are the top coats UV protective? Absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah. So the last one we showed, the SC10 with the ALX Pro, is UV resistant. And of course, the sealer we're going to use with this system is as well. We have a lot of options when it comes to sealers and a lot of UV resistant sealers.
So Mike's just again kind of detailing, taking that tape off, making sure you've got some really clean, you know, good looking edges here. And same thing, just kind of lightly scrape. So you'll notice, so this is our grout coat. This is a base to the pattern we're about to install. So you do put the grout throughout the entire surface. And then usually kind of allow this to dry overnight so that when you do your pattern installation, that cement doesn't pull up at all.
And as Mike did, he scraped any high spots. It'll make the tape or your stone strips, whatever you're using to create a pattern, lay a little smoother and nicer.
So we're showing two different products here. So we're showing our grout tape, which can be used to, what we're showing here is to create kind of a border on this flagstone pattern. This grout tape, the CA60 can also be used just to create, you know, a tile pattern or any type of pattern. Bill's created some really cool patterns in the past. So sky's the limit.
It's important to know with the grout tape, you can do a tile pattern or offset squares or rectangular patterns. And you can make them any size, which is kind of nice. But you still want to make sure you have a square and you're making sure that you're square and you're straight. you know, so there is still a little skill involved with when you're doing tile patterns with the grout tape. A little more forgiving, in my opinion, with the stone strips.
Yes.
So here they're just putting down our stone strips, our CA50 stone strips, that to create like a simulated stone type pattern. Mm-hmm.
And like Bill mentioned, this is a little more forgiving, but you do kind of want to, you know, look at your pattern to make sure there wasn't some funky line in there or something created some weird, you know, shape. So if it's not desirable, just take that stone strip off and relay another one. Skip trowel texture. This is fun. we're moving to a different cement here. So we're going to our TC2, which is a smooth trowel, a smooth texture cement. And then sticking with that WP81 cement modifier.
So the TC2 is a white cement. And we have our TC40 here you're gonna see, which is our liquid colorant. So this is great to create a color for your texture. Something different than your grout coat. So when you stain it, you do get that contrast. So here he's adding the TC40. When you're doing this with TC2, it is really critical to make sure you're measuring and making sure every batch has the same amount of colorant. So that you have consistent coloring throughout.
Yeah, that's really important. There's nothing worse than, you know, one mixture looking different than the other and you don't find out until it all dries. So again, here we've laid out our pattern and then this mixture will get troweled across the entire surface.
And the TC2 again mixes with WP81, same mix ratio as the TC5. We do have a lot of color options and different dilution ratios for the TC40. So it's very customizable. As a matter of fact, our water-based stain blends color chart, it kind of includes a recipe for you to integrally color the TC2 and the stains that'll be utilized to achieve the color that you're looking for. Mm-hmm. One thing to know too, Mike's doing the skip trowel here. If you got large areas, it's important to have guys that have a similar technique. Especially if they're troweling side by side, you don't want to come out later and see like a 4-foot swath that looks different than the area adjacent. And there's a lot of different ways to do a skip trowel. So Mike here is troweling and he's kind of doing a dashing technique similar to like a stucco as he goes. And he's going to come back and kind of just knock out his high spots. You could also do a tight trowel coat over the tape, the stone strips, and then come back and just apply sporadically your texture. So a lot of control here, a lot of different options available to suit your needs. This is where mock-ups become very important because we can send you a sample of this finish, but if your crew has a different technique for the skip trowel, it could be difficult to replicate. So it's always important to create your own samples so that you can achieve it when you get the job.
Yeah, and I think something to note there too is that not only the texture, but the color, you know, we had just mentioned, you know, there's kind of multiple ways to add colorant to these bags. And then, your coloring method may be slightly off from ours. And so really, really mock-ups are going to be really important with custom finishes.
And I love Paul's comment in the chat there. If you start troweling bad, keep troweling bad. Consistency is key because, your pattern's going to really help break it up. So, troweling bad is not necessarily the end of the world.
It's so true. It's very good point. Yeah. Alrighty. So when would you remove your grout tape? What point? Where? How dry is this? How wet is this?
Well, it's going to depend on the temperature. Mm-hmm. You know, usually once you're able to access it, walk on it, you can pull your tape. How thick you go with the texture can play into that as well. Mm-hmm. You don't want to let it sit too long. You end up getting broken edges that kind of chatter. Mm-hmm. Which isn't the end of the world on a flagstone look. Kind of makes it look a little more natural. But again, you can see Mike just knocking down any high spots here. Again, with the rub stone. Now, obviously in a big area, you may want to use a pole scraper. You may even want to use a floor sanding machine with a screen just to knock down your high spots. So that's all he's doing there is just knocking them down.
So we can see, so really, again, something to note here, the grout, is a different color. It's going to give you that contrast. You could absolutely do it with the same exact color. You know, your options are really endless here. So again, kind of dialing in what you need for your project is pretty important when it comes to these custom finishes.
Yeah. Pro tip, when you're doing your samples and you're showing your customers, do it with a darker grout. All right. So that way you can pull your grout lines and stain everything. It's going to save you labor, save you a little bit of stress. If you can go that route. Now, that's not to say we can't do a lighter grout and stain and then pull, but it's gonna be easier for you if you can pull your pattern and stain everything and still have that contrast between the grout and the texture. just from a labor standpoint.
It's very, very true. And we'll kind of show you that method here. So our SC35 is our water-based stain. With all of these stains, you know, you're just going to want to make sure you mix them up real good. Make sure that, you know, no colorant kind of settled or anything like that.
And strain them, you know, paint strainer when you're pouring it into the pump, the sprayer there is definitely a good idea. Nothing worse than you're halfway through the deck and your sprayer clogs and you're having to take it apart, pull the filter out. Not a bad idea to strain your stain. Here he's just spraying water. By doing this, it's by pre-wetting the surface, making sure you don't have any puddles. You just want to kind of pre-wet it, cool the surface. This will allow the stain to move, give you a little more control. Really critical when it's hot. You don't want the stain just to kind of land and dry immediately. You want to have a little movement with it to where you can broom it in.
And I think what Mike did in the cup there is pretty important too. You know, kind of check your sprayer, make sure it's not doing something funky when it's spraying your stain out.
Well, he had water in the line too, so he wanted to make sure he was spraying stain before he started. So but you can see he's staining right over the grout and it still has that contrast. So it's definitely the easier way to go versus leaving the stenciling and the grout tape down, staining, and then pulling the tape. What happens there is potentially you could have some bleeders or the sides of the texture, if you leave the tape in place, may show the color underneath and not the stain color. So the integral color you put. So you may see all the sides of your joint. So definitely easier if you can pull your tape and then stain like we're doing here.
Firming it into the surface is just a really nice way to get a consistent, you know, color here. Depending on your texture, you might get 150, 250 square feet per gallon. So, you know, if you're got a lot of texture there, it might not, you know, go as long.
Well, and spraying the water on the deck first will help you.
Absolutely.
Like I said, that movement translates to yield, you know, so. And here he's just kind of picture framing the border, you know, doing another coat to darken it up to give you that contrast. You know, the water-based stains, the SC35, there's, you know, a lot of, you can brush it, you can spray it, you can dilute it, you can go neat, you can do multiple coats to get more of a solid color. Always best when done in thin coats though. What you don't want to do is just puddle the stain on the deck. Create problems.
And you can see here again, like we mentioned, the grout's taking a different color, you know, than the simulated stones, and then adding that extra on the border just kind of gives a little bit more of a pop. So now onto our sealer. So sealer here, we're going to move to a clear sealer. So we're looking at our SC70, which is an acrylic lacquer, single component sealer. This is going to come in 1 gallon and 5 gallon buckets. Again, we are kind of noting here our CA30, that small safe grip, which you can add up to a quart per 5 gallons of this SC70.
Yeah, that's kind of our standard, but you can adjust the mix ratio to suit your needs. Again, mock-ups, you know, with various textures and getting the end user to sign off is always good. You want them to decide.
Yeah.
So, and this SC70, the acrylic lacquer sealer, one of the benefits here is it does dry pretty quickly, does have a solvent odor to it, so that's worth noting, and it is UV resistant. It also provides a wet look, so if you are looking for more of a semi-gloss or maybe a flat type satin finish, you would move into our water-based polyurethanes or solvented polyurethanes and away from the SC70.
Mm-hmm. Same thing here, you know, thin to win, roll the product thin. It's pretty easy product to put down. Should dry fairly quickly. And again, we will kind of show you a little bit about maintenance here.
Establish a routine maintenance schedule for your decorative coating. The MACoat system should be inspected for wear every 2 to 4 years. The system should be resealed with the appropriate Westcoat sealer every 3 to 5 years, depending on traffic and UV exposure. For additional information, refer to the spec sheets and general maintenance guide. These resources can be found at www.westcoat.com. If you have any additional questions, feel free to contact us via email.
I don't see any new questions here. Again, if you've got any questions, go ahead and pop them into the chat. But one thing I do want to show you guys real quick right now is
at westcoat.com.
A product that we, you know, within the last few years have come out with. This is it's called our WP. Wrap. It's our WP wrap. This is a flashing detail that you can use. So again, we'll show this promo. And if you have any questions, go ahead and definitely pop those into the chat.
Hey everyone, my name is Todd Cook. I'm the product manager here at Westcoat. I want to talk to you guys about our WP wrap. Our WP wrap is a supplemental waterproofing technique that can be used in tandem with our ALX, ALX Pro, and MACoat waterproofing systems. It involves two components. The first is our WP45 flashing fabric. The second is the WP95 waterproofing membrane. Together, these two materials are used to address critical waterproofing areas around perimeters, posts, and through penetrations. They allow for a little bit more versatility over your traditional metal flashing. They can also be used in tandem with metal flashing to offer additional waterproofing and protection and corrosion resistance. So the first product I want to talk about is the WP45 flashing fabric. The WP45 flashing fabric is a high-performance, non-woven polyester engineering fabric. It's specifically designed to be used with WP95 waterproofing membrane in the Westcoat's WP wrap system. This material significantly reduces reflective cracking, it's flexible, resists tearing, has high tensile strength, and is easy to install with its non-adhesive backing. It's tough and durable. The roll itself comes in 300 linear feet, 10 inches wide, and 300 feet long. The WP45 flashing fabric can also be used anywhere a flexible reinforcing fabric may be needed. Here, we can see the fabric outside of the packaging. So here you can see the WP45 flashing fabric is extremely flexible, allowing you to detail up against metal flashing, posts, or any other troubled areas that you might need to flash. You will see on the back side, there is a fuzzy side. That is the fuzzy side that needs to go down into the wet WP95 material, and then you would apply additional WP95 on top. Now that we've taken some time to talk about the WP45 flashing fabric, I do want to take a moment here to talk about the WP95 waterproofing membrane. Here we have a cured sample of the WP95 and WP45 together. Westcoat's WP95 waterproofing membrane is an asphalt-modified latex elastomeric membrane that's designed to create a thin-section, seamless, reinforced waterproofing membrane barrier. It provides superior positive-side waterproofing protection. The WP95 incorporates an antimicrobial component that inhibits the growth of mold and mildew on the membrane surface and in damp environments. This material is solvent-free, non-flammable, seamless, provides a monolithic waterproofing membrane, it has excellent adhesion properties, and maintains elastomeric properties at low temperatures. This material comes in 5-gallon pails and offers a 1-year shelf life. So now that we've seen the WP45 flashing fabric, as well as the WP95 waterproofing membrane, you kind of get an idea of how these products are used to help support and create additional waterproofing at some of the critical areas. If you have any questions on the WP wrap or either of these products, feel free to contact us directly at westcoat.com.
Alrighty, so again, if you do have any questions about that WP flash wrap, now's a good time to put them in the chat. Again, it's just kind of another extra product that we have you can utilize on site if you need it. So real quick, we're gonna do a question for a raffle prize, and the raffle prize this time is going to be a Westcoat water bottle. So first person to put the answer in the chat or Q&A box will win. The question is, what is the CSP number we are looking for in the prep for the MACoat system? 2, 3 to 4, Evan. Woo, everybody, I like it.
That's too easy.
That was quick. I know, that was too easy. Right,
what's the fastest land animal?
If you get that one, we have Westcoat masks to send to you. Fastest land animal, go.
Cheetah, who you got?
Yeah, Maria, all right. Okay, you get some swag too. That was a bonus question.
That's right.
I like it.
She hasn't seen me run though.
Yeah, it's actually Bill. Yeah. Okay, so like I said, thank you for all of you who stayed on for the entire call. You're all gonna be entered into a raffle for a $200 Westcoat material credit. So thanks for your participation, and we will reach out to you next week to get that out to you. One thing we do like to cover at the very end is just our website. And so again, if you have any questions, feel free to continue to enter those into the chat, and we will go ahead and answer those for you. One thing that Bill and I had noticed, and
can you scroll down on the Q&A?
Oh, yes.
Up, I should say.
Sorry, we've got a question. Oh, Ryan came in with three on the Q&A for the CSP there.
And while you're doing that, I'll answer Michael's question about the TC30. So the TC30 can be done up to 3 inches in one lift. Absolutely no problem doing multiple lifts if needed, even if you're going up to three. So, but yeah, you can do 3 inches to zero in one lift with the TC30.
Yeah, great question. I'm seeing that hopefully the website's coming through okay on your guys' end. Might take a second to load here. One thing that Bill and I had, kind of realized is we didn't really talk about drain details. So if you're on our website and up here at the top, it says resources. And on the right-hand side, when you scroll down, it has architectural details. And so the architectural details page is going to have all of the details for any of our systems for waterproofing. And we also have details for our epoxy systems. The ALX Pro system does have an overall detail, which is a really great detail. Again, you can use this in submittal packages. This is something that is a really helpful tool. But the one thing we definitely wanted to touch on is the drains. So let me find that real quick. A better one.
Maybe at the systems page, ALX Pro systems page, I saw a better one.
We know we have it somewhere.
Except that's standard, not pro.
Oh.
Come on, Mal.
Come on,
maybe
Mal.
Take the mouse.
Come on, Mal. Just let Bill take over. He knows where everything's at.
So also, while we're at it, so if you go to the systems page up here, then you can also get to all the information for that system. So we do have a little redundancy built in here to get to important information. There you go. That's a little better detail. So, drains are critical. We didn't really touch on it in the demo, but one of the things we look for is that flange you see around the Westcoat graded drain there. And we want to make sure that you're either using our WP35 ALX drain or a Thunderbird style deck drain for these coating systems. So similar to how we did the perimeter detail with the flashing, how we kind of tapered it, you're gonna do the same thing around the drain there, but you can see the whole process as far as the system and how you kind of taper it down into the drain. But it is critical to make sure you have that flanged drain for waterproofing purposes.
Yeah, very important detail. We run across, drains all the time that just aren't the proper drain for this type of system. So again, if you even run into that out in the field and you need help, you need support, reach out to your Westcoat rep, happy to help you out there. So the other thing that we wanted to touch on, and again, back to this system page. So again, up here, in the top bar, all of our systems that we have specifications for, we'll have a landing page just like this. So we're happen to be on the ALX Pro page here, and you'll see architectural drawings, color charts, things that pertain to that system itself. And then the ALX Pro one, we are actually working on a video.
Also reports. So if you need part of the submittal process, if you need your ICC, class A 1 hour fire rated, which you often will, when you're providing submittal, we do have that. So we do have the ICC evaluation, and with all the ALX finished systems.
Yep, absolutely. And so up here under, photos and videos. If you click on that section there, photo gallery is going to be up top first there. But if you kind of see this quick navigation at the top, you'll see training videos in the middle. and it can take you down to all of the training videos we offer. So right now we do have an ALX, standard training video. You can kind of get to the videos this way. You can also go to our YouTube page. So it is Westcoat SCS on YouTube. And that is also going to give you some great, videos. It's going to have a lot more content than just our training videos, but kind of those product spotlights we had talked about today, those are going to be there. If we've got, project profiles on different projects, those can be on our YouTube page as well. So kind of a couple different ways to find those trainings. But absolutely the Westcoat website is a really great resource for finding those training videos.
And we got a question about the weight for ALX Pro, and it's about 2.5 pounds per square foot.
Mm-hmm. Good question.
And the MACoat, if it matters, is just about a pound. So 2.5 pounds for the ALX system. So very light.
It does matter. One thing I really like to touch on too, and again, if you've been to one of our, virtual demos before, we probably have said, too much about this material estimator, but I don't think you can say too much about it. It is a really, really great resource for you. So again, any of our systems that we have, full system specs for, we've got this drop-down menu and this material estimator. Today we talked about the ALX Pro standard system. So let's say we are interested in covering 50,000 square feet, because that sounds like a good size project to me. And it'll give you some breakdowns for how much material you're going to need total. It'll give you a breakdown as well for, each step. So all of the steps we talked about today, kind of, breaking down each part of the process and how much material you would need or you might need. This is an estimate. So that's a really, really great tool we've got. Can you think of anything else? I also wanted to quickly touch on our QCA or Qualified Contractor Applicator Program. If you aren't enrolled in that yet, please reach out to us if you're interested. Back here on the homepage over here, QCA Benefits, this is going to kind of give you a rundown of some pros to become a QCA with Westcoat. Project specific warranties is a really good one. We do have, co-op and rebate programs. It's just really partnering up with us. And we're partners with everybody, even if you're not a QCA, but this is something that we really do like to highlight if you're interested in becoming a QCA with us.
And leads, we tend to give leads to our QCAs.
Yeah, so, yeah.
It's important to know.
Absolutely. Can you think of anything else to cover on the website? I don't think there's much else there. We don't have any additional questions. So we did pretty good. We were trying to get this done in 90 minutes and here we are. We will send out a follow-up email. Follow-up email will have contact information for all of your local Westcoat reps. But if you have any questions, that info@westcoat.com, you can always email us there. You can also, reach out to us by phone, whatever we can do to help you, support you on your projects, we are here for you. All right. No more questions. We're good to go.
All right. Well, thanks everybody. Appreciate you joining us today.
Everybody have a great day. Thank you so much.